a kid, I was repeatedly asked the quintessential kid question, what do you want to be when you grow up? So the girl to the right of me usually said, I want to be a doctor so I can help people. And the boy to the left of me usually said, I want to be a firefighter. And every once in a while, you would have a kid who would say, I want to be a gazillionaire when I grew up. And so you knew that was the kid that you needed to be friends with. But for me, I always wanted to be a librarian. Why? Because I wanted to spend the rest of my life reading books. And I remember that as a kid, my one dream for when I grew up was to have a library just like Belle did in Beauty and the Beast. A library that was so wide and so expansive that it only left a sliver of the wall and required a ladder just to get to some of the books. And fortunately for me, this library does exist in a monastery in Austria, and so my dream continues to hopefully visit there one day. But the reason that I'd always loved reading was because within each book, I could be in the midst of a sword fight between Arthur's, Porthos, or Remus from the Three Musketeers, or I could be learning about why a plane flew. And so for me, each book represented a new fact, a new experience that I previously hadn't known. And I often worried as a kid that there was so much to know, so much to learn, so much to experience that I couldn't possibly finish reading all of the books that I needed to. And so as I grew older, I became the very definition of a bookworm. I always had three books with me, a classic, a nonfiction science book, and a Scientific American magazine. And I often felt that the most prized possession in my room was not my piggy bank, which had $1,549.22, but instead my bookshelf, which had 134 books, 99 which I've read, as well as 60 Scientific American magazines. And I always had this weird habit as a kid. I would read texts that were too challenging for me that just went over my head. For example, this one time in the fifth grade, I embarked on this rather Odyssey-like journey to read Stephen Hawking's A Brief History of Time. And so after a couple of long, arduous weeks, I aborted that mission and decided to read Stephen Hawking's other book, A Briefer History of Time. And so fortunately for me, I was able to finish reading this book, but it did have its own difficulties. Throughout the whole entire reading, I felt like it was an archaeologist, like I was taking something completely unknown and abstract and having to uncover familiar pieces and parts and string them together in order to make sense of this rather abstract book. But it was this desire to learn, this desire to find out more about physics and how this world worked, which was what let me keep going and keep reading challenging texts. So it was this love of reading, this love of learning, and this naivety to take on challenging texts that led me to contact a professor at a local university. I told him very simply, all I wanted to do was to learn, that I'd been reading about his research in a magazine, and that I exhausted the Google button looking up information about his research, and I wanted to come directly to the source to find out right there what he was doing with his research. And so the logical answer to say to a 14-year-old girl who wants to come work in your lab is no, which is exactly what he said. But after a couple dozen emails on my behalf, trying to convince him, we eventually reached a compromise. He said, I can't give you access to my lab, but what I can do is I can give you a stack of articles that will be more current, more in-depth, and more comprehensive than the articles that you'll be reading in Scientific American. So I take home the stack of articles, and I'm so excited because I think to myself, I'm going to stay up all night and finish reading these articles, and tomorrow I'll be back asking for more articles. So I sit down with my highlighter, and I start highlighting words that I don't know. This is what my paper looked like when I was done. Nearly every single word, except for maybe prepositions, had been highlighted. And a stack of papers that I thought would maybe take only one night to read ended up taking 3 months. And I spent every single day of that first year, not in the lab, but in the medical school library, using textbooks to look up concepts that I didn't know. But it was this love of learning, this desire to want to learn more about what I was reading that allowed me to persevere through those long nights and to work through that archaic foreign language of science research. And eventually, an article that took maybe a week to read only took a couple of months. And so I'd like to share with you some of the information that I learned. I learned primarily about the current problems facing current cancer treatments. I learned about the necessity to develop more sensitive diagnostic tools in order to improve cancer diagnosis. I also learned about the need to localize treatment in order to minimize toxicity to healthy cells in order to improve patient quality of life during treatment. And I also learned about cancer stem cells, a recently discovered subset of cancer cells that are identified for initiating driving tumor growth, inducing metastasis, which is the spread of tumor growth around the body, as well as cancer recurrence and drug resistance. And then finally, I learned about theranostics, which is the combination of therapy and diagnostics into a single platform with the hopes of improving cancer treatment, as well as making it more personalized. And so to me, all of this research was just mind-blowing, because it really was cooler than science fiction. But what made this experience, this reading adventure, truly unique was that I started realizing that a lot of the information that I was reading around these articles were being translated into projects in the lab. And so to me, this was more mind-blowing, because essentially this meant that the text, the information, was coming to life by forming a foundation for a new idea, a potential new treatment for cancer. And so I started thinking to myself, could I possibly do the same thing? Could I take something that I've been learning about for the past year and translate it into a project? And so I went to my professor and I asked him that very question, and he said his favorite word, no. But I'd been hearing that word a lot from him, and I knew that about 2 out of every 10 no's he said actually meant yes. So I went home and I sketched out an idea. And this idea was based on the information I'd been learning. So my idea was to create an iron oxide gold dumbbell nanoparticle that had 3 main functions based on what I'd been reading. So the first function of my nanoparticle is to specifically target cancer cells. And so how it does this is this iron oxide nanoparticle is linked with a peptide that specifically targets and binds to biomarkers that are overexpressed on only cancer and cancer stem cells. So this was borrowing the idea of just targeting cancer cells while leaving normal cells unharmed. And so the second characteristic of my nanoparticle is this photothermal control drug-releasing characteristic. So essentially what this means is that the gold nanoparticle is coated with this smart polymer that when it's heated by an external laser that's aimed at the tumor, it causes the smart polymer to collapse, shrink, and therefore squeeze out the preloaded drug directly at the tumor site. And so this was borrowing the idea of localizing treatment in order to minimize toxicity to the healthy cells and hopefully improve patient quality of life during treatment. And so the third characteristic of my nanoparticle was borrowed from this idea of theranostics. The previous 2 characteristics dealt with therapy, and now I was starting to wonder if I could incorporate diagnostics in some way. And so since my nanoparticles have metallic properties, I thought they could be used as contrast agents for multiple imaging tools, such as MRI, Raman, or photoacoustical imaging. And this allows the nanoparticle to not only act as a detection tool, a diagnostic tool, but it can also act as a tool to monitor the real-time response of treatment efficacy. And so I have a video here to show you guys what essentially this nanoparticle does when it's all put together.
Angela's idea was to mix cancer medicine in a polymer that would attach to these nanoparticles. Nanoparticles that would then attach to cancer cells and show up on an MRI so doctors could see exactly where the tumors are. Then she thought, what if you aimed an infrared light at the tumors to melt the polymer and release the medicine, thus killing the cancer cells while leaving healthy cells completely unharmed?
And so the overall goal of this project was essentially just to personalize cancer treatment in order to improve the efficacy as well as to improve the patient quality of life during treatment. So I took this idea to my professor, and I was hoping that he would say anything but no, and in fact he did. He made a bunch of corrections and a bunch of modifications, and he said, okay, I guess you could start working on this. So I spent the next 3 years and several hundred hours and failing every single night, having failed synthesizations working on this project. But one day, this project went from an idea that I'd been reading about from something in an article to something real. In fact, it was so real that I was able to present this project as well as my results to President Obama at the White House Science Fair this past February. And so all I did was pursue this knowledge, this love of learning, and I had this unique experience of realizing how exciting it was to change information, translate information into something tangible. And so now that I'm a senior in high school, I'm being asked the quintessential senior in high school questions, like, what college are you going to? What are you going to major in? And that same question of, what do you want to be when you grow up? Except now it's more intimidating. It's, what are you going to do with the rest of your life? But my answer stays the same. I want to spend the rest of my life learning everything possible. Except now, I also want to translate these ideas, make the information come to life by creating a project that I hope will help society. Thank you.